All right, well, thanks for everyone for being here. This is we've got a good 2-hour block. I'm happy to be able to move forward and talk about the Humboldt River issues at this stage where we're at now. Thanks for those of you who are here in person. There's a lot of people who have called in. It's over 60 people who are listening. Thank you for your involvement. I'll start with kind of intros and how we're gonna do this. I'm just starting off with some opening comments. We have a slide for that, don't we? Yeah. All right, here's what we're trying to cover. The purpose of this meeting. And actually I'll back up a little bit. Initially, what we've been talking about internally is we're at a point with the model development and the conceptual management planning stage where it's important to start bringing the science with management thinking more together and really start getting into details of what are we gonna do? How are we gonna use these models really with some specific examples and get everybody understanding where we're going and what the limitations and what the opportunities are and share what we're thinking and get input from others. So what we had been talking about was bringing together a working group of individuals who kind of represent different water user groups to get different perspectives and use that group as a way of digging into different concepts and evaluating effectiveness and feasibility and using that as our next stage. But we got a lot of feedback recommending that we sort of broaden that conversation because there are so many people that are interested and have good ideas and could be affected by what comes out of this process. And so we made the decision to hold this meeting and open it up really to anybody who's interested so we can have as much of a sort of a public thought process as we can. So I'm going to start with some comments about the overall needs and purpose. Levi's got a section on 2023 water supply, which is all great news. And then John Benedict, Kip Allender are really going to get into the meat of what we're talking about. We're talking about the model development that we've been working on with USGS and DRI for several years. Work through some examples of what those models give us. And what are some examples of scenarios that can be evaluated to address the issue with potential conflict and reducing conflict in the Humboldt River? And also, you know, by extension, some of the things that some limitations of what the model kind of how far that can take us and what we can't do with that. And I'll close with some discussion on direction forward, what this means for you as a water right holder, how you can be continue to be heard and involved in the process and the timeline for that. And then we're gonna have we think this will be about an hour, so we'll have time for questions and answers here. Okay, so without getting into the details, the issue, I think, I'm not sure exactly who's online listening to this, but I think most of you have been participating in the annual model updates with USGS and DRI and other public meetings that we've had and are familiar with the problems, issues, and the limitations with water management in the Humboldt River region. In a nutshell, groundwater pumping development over a couple of generations has had some impact on capturing, reducing flow in the Humboldt River. Senior rights are in the river. To reduce the flow in the river has impact and conflict with those senior rights. And as a state, or prior appropriation state, we have the responsibility and there's the necessity to protect those senior rights. The difficulty is it's really hard to quantify the magnitude, exact location of where that conflict is arising and occurring from, and what the how to quantitatively demonstrate benefits without causing undue harm to others by reducing something that's causing that conflict. So this is where the models come in. I just really appreciate how much work the USGS and DRI has done over the years to really develop robust models that have direct application to solve real world problems. It's what we're doing here is unprecedented in Nevada. And I know it's taken many years. There's been frustrations that we can't act faster, that we can't respond and resolve these problems quicker. But I think it's important to understand it is kind of an unprecedented process. There's been some examples around the Arid West where there've been similar projects or there's similar issues and developments that are happening now. But it's really important that we get this right, that the basis that we're making decisions on going forward is really accurate and defensible. And that's more important than rushing. So we'll be hearing about the status of the models, work through some examples, and what I'm hoping is that this will generate some thought on your part about what we might be missing, about concepts that are being overlooked that deserve more attention, and we want to be able to open it up and hear from all of you and make sure to include the best ideas that you might have too. Let's see. So I do want to extend compliments to our staff, both to our hydrology staff who have really worked through this on a technical level, to our water rights staff who are responsible for processing permits and communicating some of our limitations to the people who are waiting on us to take action, and navigating, trying to help people as much as we can, but also recognizing and trying to communicate what those limitations are. A lot of people have behind the scenes have been contributing to make this a long-term successful project, both for the users in the Humboldt River region and for the division. Our field staff, and here I have to make the announcement that I don't know if Kirk is on the line right now, but Kirk Owsley, who's our supervising water commissioner in the Elko office, is retiring this week. He's been on the job for 30 years, and he's just a wealth of knowledge and a really great guy to work with. The business is a picture of Roger Grist and Chester, who were longtime water commissioners in the Elko office. So I just want to extend on behalf of everybody, Kirk, congratulations. And I hope you're not too far off when we need to call you occasionally to ask about the history. And also Landon Harris, who has been in our office in Elko, is taking the reins for Kirk as the supervising water commissioner. And we're really fortunate to have Landon in that role. Also really great guy. He's been working with Kirk closely for nearly 10 years. So everything's in good hands with Landon. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Levi.
All right, thanks everyone. I just have a few quick slides to talk about our water year so far. As many of you know, all of you know, we've had quite a winter, which has resulted in the upper and lower Humboldt basins being at about 200% of normal. That's on the right-hand slide. And I don't have a visible mouse. On the left-hand side is last year, where we were at about 76 and 66% respectively for the lower and upper Humble. So we're doing quite a bit better this year. This plot is showing snow water equivalent for the upper Humboldt basin. And so you can see the maximum, which is the purple line, which I included on this slide because we're kind of creeping up on that this year, which is the black line. And then the green is median, and 2022 is the red line. So again, another illustration of how much bigger this water year is. This is the drought comparison slide. So last year is on the left, with a significant portion of the state in severe or extreme or worse drought. And then the right-hand slide is showing, or sorry, the right-hand image is showing much reduced drought conditions across most of the state. This slide is showing the Humboldt River inlay. On the left, you have the median flow in yellow and the daily flow in blue. So inlays flowing, that arrived on March 2nd, and it's expected to flow for the remainder of the irrigation season. And then on the right-hand panel here, we're showing the correlation between drought cycles and zero flow days at inlay, which is the black line. Droughts are on the in the orange boxes. And it's important to note that, as we say every year, the supplemental flows from Lone Tree have masked the zero flow days at inlay in the 90s and 2000s. So it makes it look better than it really was. Okay, this is the reservoir storage comparison. We've got Rye Patch on the top. It's pretty similar to last year with about 9,500 acre feet. It's about 5% of capacity. Long is doing a little bit better, 42% of capacity at 130,000 acre feet versus 34% of capacity for last year. And then we have preliminary pumpage estimates for the Humboldt region, 2018 to 2021. And really, I think the takeaway on this slide is that the majority of use is irrigation, followed by mining, followed by a smaller amount of municipal. And then everything else is, all the other uses are quite small in comparison. And one note on here, in case a question comes up later, is that the industrial uses, which is the red, toward the bottom, those include power production. So now I will pass it over to John for the model report status and timelines.
Thanks, Levi.
Did you want the mouse pointer on there?
I do. Okay, we got the mouse pointer. Cool.
But you remember that's sticking there, it's sticking there, so you want to shut it off the side. You're not using it.
So yeah, I've got two items that I'm going to speak about today. The first, I'm going to talk a little bit about the status of the modeling reports and expected timelines for those. I think they've been long awaited, and so everybody is likely interested in understanding our best estimate of completion and release of those to the public. One thing I would like to say is that the actual models themselves are complete, and they have been in this process that's really been ongoing for the last almost year and a half, perhaps two for some of these models, has been all about technical reviews, editing revisions, consistency between reports, and being able to communicate that information as clearly and
transparently as possible. So while the models haven't changed, and many of the folks who have participated in our annual reports have seen those results are materially the same. And I'm going to do a little bit of summary on that. But first, I want to talk a little bit about the status and the timeline for each of these three models, and maybe start with just a brief overview of where these models exist in space. I know that many people have seen figures like the one I'm showing here in the past and are familiar with the fact that we do have three separate models and three separate modeling reports. But I'd like to go through that a little bit right now. So we've got what we call the upper, middle, and lower models. And starting in the upper, the reason we call that the upper, obviously, is it's in the headwaters of the Humboldt River Basin area. And that upper model is shown here in green. Is that cursor? And this model is the model's completed, and the report is being completed by Desert Research Institute. That model extends throughout the headwaters down to the Carlin Gauge and covers what we call the upper portion of the Humboldt. The other model, middle model, is being completed by the USGS, and that model extends from the Carlin Gauge all the way down to the Inlet Gauge. It's really the largest piece of the geographic area. And then the lower model is being completed by the USGS and the Desert Research Institute jointly. And that one starts on the east side of the Inlet Gauge and continues down to the Humboldt Sink. So I'm going to talk about each one separately because they really are on separate tracks and they're being done independently to some extent. So looking at the upper, again shown in green, the model report's gone through technical peer review, and it's gone through an internal or courtesy review by Division of Water Resources. Those comments have been provided to the authors, and as I understand it, the authors have made all the peer review edits, and they are completing any revisions needed as a consequence of our review. And they've estimated that that's kind of the final author edits and sort of a standard review will be performed in April and May, with the report available for public release sometime in June. One thing I'd like to note about this model, just as a general characteristic, is that this is where most of the surface water originates, the headwaters of the Humboldt region. It may have the highest degree of uncertainty due to the limited amount of data up here regarding surface water flows, and also sort of a limited understanding of how surface water and groundwater interact. It's just kind of something to think about. The middle model is a little bit further behind. It's really the most complex section of the river area and the watershed, I think, mainly because there's so much more data there. Got the greatest amount of groundwater pumping, and all of the mines within this region tend to be within that area. So there's quite a lot of data that goes into this model. It has multiple gauging stations, including the Carlin Gauge, Palisade Gauge, Dunphy, Battle Mountain, Comus, and Kimley. And these things help immensely in calibrating the model with respect to accurately simulating capture. So it's a pretty important model. This one's undergone peer review, and those review comments are being addressed right now by the authors. It awaits our review, and USGS expects that report to come to us towards the end of April. We expect to complete that review by the end of May, turn it back to them, and then they will have their final author edits over the summer and the standards review after that, with expected completion sometime in October for public release. Lastly, the lower model. This is the smallest of the three areas. It's got the least amount of pumping. It's I characterize it as being kind of the least complicated because of the lack of pumping. But it's the core area for surface water irrigation in Lovelock. So there's a substantial amount of surface water decree rights that are being used and are dependent on in Lovelock. This one's just a little bit ahead, I think, of the upper model at this point. It's undergone all the technical reviews. I think as of today, the authors have made their final edits associated with our review of that model. And so this one simply needs to go through the standards review for the document. And we expect the completion on that one, hopefully to be in June as well. So that's a brief summary of status of the model reports and timeline. So now I'm going to switch gears a little bit and talk something about the model results. What do we know from models? What are we getting out of these models? What can we expect to get out of these models? And what kind of products are we going to be utilizing going forward in the future? And again, many of these things have been talked about in previous discussions, particularly for the annual updates on the models. But I'm going to try to basically just kind of summarize this in general terms. So I've outlined here kind of the way I've thought about model products, I guess, and the components that are of interest to us, and then kind of boil it down into four different components. Capture quantity, understanding about the stream aquifer connection, more information on site-specific impacts, and then how the models might be able to be used as something like a management tool. And these components kind of translate into different types of products. And, you know, the key example product types include regional capture plots that tell us something about the historical capture over the period of time that we've modeled in history, which is from pre-development to 2015, I think, for all models. And then we use those models to forecast the future based on maybe conservative estimates of what the future looks like in terms of pumping and climate. And those plots can go out for 100 years. And we look at, well, how much additional capture might there be over that period of time if things stay relatively the same? From the standpoint of the stream aquifer connection, really that's all about what is the nature of this connection and where are there maybe greater or less potential for capture on a regional scale. So this component is really related to just how well is the river or tributaries connected to the aquifer system, and in what places might there be more concerns than others. And for this component, we kind of look at the capture maps as telling that sort of a story. And we've talked about those before. These capture maps tend to be something like what I call a risk map, if you will. It doesn't map out where capture is actually occurring, but it does map out areas where there's greater risk for capture or susceptibility to capture if you put a well in that area. So if you have a well in an area that's got higher risk for capture, it will have captured more, but the maps don't really pay attention to where those wells are. It's really just cover the whole area and look at where, if you put a well, what would that capture look like? And we'll talk about that in more detail. Then the site-specific information, that's really the capture query tool that we talked about before. And this is a product that the USGS is working on. It's going to be applied to all the models where any user can go online and pick a point. Maybe it's a place where they might want to put a well. Maybe it's a place where they have a well. And they can understand more about the impacts that that well has when it's pumped on stream flow capture. And finally, and this is an important one, and one we haven't talked about too much, and Kip's going to focus on this one, how can the models be used as sort of a management tool or a scenario evaluation tool to look at potential solutions going forward that that may or may not be viable, but we want to know, you know, what kind of outcome might we expect if we choose some kind of a solution that we might propose to reduce capture on the river or even avoid it or eliminate. So I'm going to walk through the first three, talk about the results we have on those, and then I'm going to hand it over to Kip for the last one. Okay, capture quantity. So these are what I kind of call these curves in the middle are what I kind of call historical capture amounts or forecasted capture amount plots. And what I've got here is I've got a slide that's kind of busy, but it's got a location of each of the models and color-coded by upper, middle, and lower. And I've got a graph for each with a pointer that points to each one. So this upper one represents the upper model results, middle one is the middle model results, and the bottom one is the lower model results. And I think you notice that these are all different scales. You have to, you, hopefully you can see these. I know they're fine, but there are different scales on each of these plots. But what these show are the model simulation of capture amount per year, along with the simulations of annual pumping per year. So you'll see that the pumping, which are in the bars, has somewhat of an erratic pattern, which represents demand and use of pumping. And those amounts are actually put into the models. And then after what's called the historical period, which is 2015, pumping appears to smooth out. Well, we've made a median estimate of what that pumping is, projected it out for 100 years. And we use these models to simulate capture of stream flow, and that result is in the black line that I'm kind of hovering on in the upper one, right here. So that represents stream capture. The left axis represents on these pumping amounts, and the right axis represents stream capture, sometimes called stream depletion. To the right of that, I've got some statistics that come out of the model just to give you a number of what the models are showing. And these are rounded to the nearest 100 acre feet for each of the models. So got a sequence here of upper, middle, lower, and statistics are the same from each of those models in terms of what I'm showing. And I guess what I'd like to do maybe is walk through each one of these briefly. So if we look at the upper, what you can see is that pumping amounts in the last decade or so have been hovering around 23 to 25,000 acre feet in the upper model. And by 2015, the model simulated that there's been about 10,800 acre feet of capture in 2015 as a consequence of that historical pumping. If you project that out with the average pumping rate that we've used here, which looks to be about 23,000, you see that the 100-year forecasted capture rises, but only to 11,800. So this model simulates not too much additional capture up there over the next 100 years, assuming that pumping remains about the same. So that's good news. Sam, I can take your question.
I apologize if my question is not appropriate. I'm just wondering, you use a 100-year forecasted, why not 50 or 200 or whatever?
We wanted to be conservative about getting something that isn't really a minimum. If we're going to run the models, we wanted to run them out at least to 100, and we just felt like, you know, 100 makes a lot of sense. We may not use that as sort of some kind of a management tool, but we wanted the models to have consistent results, and we landed on 100 years for each of the three, so that if we needed that many years, we've got the data, and it's already been run and simulated, and we've got that information. There was some debate about using 50 years, but we figured we'd go longer.
Thank you.
Okay. So the other interesting thing about the upper is that this capture simulation suggests that almost 46% of the water that's being pumped derives its water from stream capture. So that's pretty substantial. It's nearly half of the pumped water that's simulated in the model captures stream flow. So that's, you know, that's a really interesting feature of this model. And we think it's fundamentally because there are just so many tributaries up in the headwaters, and there's really no way you can put a pumping well very far from any of them. And it really captures all about location. The closer you are to the river, the more you're going to capture. So from that perspective, it makes sense. You look at the middle model and those results, what you'll see is that the pumping amounts are an order of magnitude larger. So this bar here is 400,000 acre feet. So over the last 15, 20 years, we've been up in that range of 400,000 acre feet of pumping. And with that much pumping, you might expect that the capture amount would be larger, but the results here suggest that the 2015 capture amount is about 13,500 acre feet. So similar magnitude is in the upper, is an order of magnitude more pumping. If you look at the 100-year forecasted amount, that level is predicted or forecasted to rise up to 23,500 acre feet, assuming median conditions and an average pumping amount. What you'll notice here is the pumping amount steps down. We didn't include the mine pumping in this historical simulation because we just didn't know what it, didn't feel like we could predict that or come up with a median amount at this point. So here you can see the capture amount compared to 2015 doesn't quite double, but it does increase substantially from 13,500 to 23,500. So the other statistic in 2015 is that 4% of the pumped water is derived from stream capture. That's a much, much lower percentage relative to the comparison with the upper modeling. And again, here, intuitively, so much of the pumping, that the area is so broad and so widespread, and there aren't that many tributaries that flow into the Humboldt. So much of the pumping is much further away from the main stem of the Humboldt River. And so that capture is much, much lower at this point in time. Last curve down in Lovelock, the lower model. Here, pumping is minimal. Peak flows during times when supplemental water might be being used for irrigation can get up to nearly 4,000 acre feet, apparently, as simulated in the models. But in general, it tends to be closer to 1,700 to 2,000 acre feet of pumping over the historical period. Capture from that in 2015 is estimated to be about 250 acre feet. And if you forecast out with a median pumping rate of somewhere around 2,000 acre feet, it looks like the capture actually levels out and stays the same, doesn't increase substantially. Here, 15% of the pumped water is derived from stream capture. So these are interesting numbers, and you know, they're something that's worth thinking about why and what does it mean. I think some of the useful information here that's actually makes me feel good is that this 100-year forecasted capture amounts don't rise remarkably higher than what we've got now. And so under the assumptions that these pumping rates are to be expected and climate remains uniform and river median flows are representative of what's going to happen into the future, then to the extent that these models are accurate, stream capture is not going to get a lot worse. That's at least my opinion, and that seems to be what the models are telling. So if you add all this up on a region-wide scale, the models simulate 24,600 acre feet of capture in 2005, the end of the historical period. Total pumping for the entire region in 2015 was simulated about 400,000 acre feet, which is pretty consistent with some of the statistics that Levi provided for more recent years. And of that capture represents 6% of the pumped groundwater within the Humboldt River region based on model results. In terms of capture quantity, another thing that can be gleaned from these models, and this is just an example, and I think people have seen this before, is we can look at the actual capture within hydrographic areas, or if we needed to, within specific other areas. But this is a really good example from the middle model that shows something about the distribution of capture amounts within hydrographic areas. And these kinds of products and tools can allow us to drill down into problem areas and maybe look further about why is this happening. Is it because there's just a lot more pumping in an area? Is it because it's more susceptible to fit the hydrologic properties? Is it right next to the river? You know, all of these things can cause increased capture. So component number one, we've done that. Second component, stream aquifer connection. So this really translates into the capture maps we've talked about before. This is something like a contour map or a map that color codes the distribution of potential capture within the area. It's really a visual tool that illustrates areas within the region that are susceptible to capture, like a risk map, like I said before. It doesn't show where actual historical capture has happened. It shows areas where if you put a well there and it's in a hot zone or a higher capture percent zone, then you're apt to capture more water more quickly. So that's the aquifer stream connection part. If you're better connected to the aquifer, you're going to capture water from the stream more rapidly and at a greater rate. So these things, as I said, are color-coded based on capture percent. And this is the most recent version of all the models' results combined. I know it's also small, but essentially what you can see here, if you can follow along with the color codes, is that the hot colors represent areas that are more susceptible to capture. In other words, they're better connected to either the river or tributaries. And the areas that are in this map that are gray or dark gray are either bedrock or areas that have less than 10% capture. So the gray areas basically are in the area, if you will, of uncertainty relative to capture, much less than for capture in those areas. And if you look through this map, what you'll see is you'll see some zones that have blossomed out, warm zones, and some zones that are very narrow and focused. And I think an obvious thing you see is in the upper model, which is again on the right hand side, you see very tight corridors along many of the tributaries where these warm colors occur. And again, those are oftentimes the area where pumping occur. Whereas you get down into the middle and you see it's a little more sporadic. The areas where even right next to the river, the capture map doesn't indicate a lot of capture, likely because there's a poor connection there, perhaps a confining layer. Other areas where it tends to blow out, areas where there's greater connection over larger distances. Similarly, in the Lovelock area, capture appears to kind of focus in along stream drainages along the main stem and doesn't extend out in too many places, except perhaps where aquifer properties are more transmissive. So I'm going to drill down into one specific area. I've shown it in this red box, if you can see that on the regional map. And I'm going to blow that up in the next slide, and we'll talk about just some examples for that. So that's this area. It's, again, a capture map. It's got the color coding, hot colors higher. I've drawn black lines on here and represented those with the percent capture, just so it's easy to tell what's what. So you see a 20% capture contour, 40% capture contour, and 60% capture contour. I've put three different well sites in there, and I've described their capture amount based on these contours. And you can, some of this might be intuitive to those out there, but I'll just walk through this and kind of play along, if you will. So this well site one is outside the 20% capture, but within the 10 to 20% capture. And the estimate might be that if you were to put a well there based on this map after 50 years, and again, this is a 50-year capture map. That's something I failed to mention on the other one, but this represents capture after 50 years of pumping. So after, if you have a well there and you pump it for 50 years continuously, after that 50th year, you will be capturing 15% of your water from the river based on the model results. Similarly, at well site two, if you had a well there, a proposal well there, you can expect after 50 years of pumping that well, capture something like 25% of your water from the Humboldt River based on this map. And then finally, site three, which is closer to the river and nearer to some warmer spots that blossom out, if you were to put a well there and pump for 50 years, the capture map would suggest that you would be capturing somewhere around 50% of your water from the Humboldt River. So that's kind of how you can use this. You can use it either for a proposed well that you might want to drill, or if you have a well in an area and you know where that is, you can zero in on that and you can use that to kind of get an estimate, quantitative estimate of how much capture you can have, assuming that you pump continuously over a 50-year period of time in this case. So this is really useful to understand that potential for capture and where it could be greater and where it's less. Last, I think this is my last slide, and the last kind of component and piece of information product that's coming out. We've talked about this before, and this is the capture tool that can provide really site-specific information for any given location within the modeled area. The model is going to be combined with their results. It's going to be live online or usable online. It'll be a tool that allow any user or any interested party to understand just how much capture would occur from an existing or proposed well over a specific period of time. These curves will go out. I think these curves go out 100 years. Is that right, Phil?
Yes.
The capture query? Okay. So the capture query tool is going to go out for 100 years. You can pick a point and you can see the curve and understand what rate of capture increase you're going to have. You can pick a given year. You can understand what the percent of capture would be after that year, year's worth of pumping. So if you pick a year 10, you pump that well for 10 years, you can expect the capture amount to be shown on the curve. In this case, I think we've got an example of a pick of about 33 years and a line that pops up, and you can trace that line right up to the free flow depletion amount, which I think is the blue line down here, and you see that that captures about 15% for that well. So really useful tool in the future, I think, for folks to use and also for us. Dan, you have a question?
John, how does one get a sense of the uncertainty of a particular query? You know, is it going to be plus or minus 10%, plus or minus 50%? How does that factor into any decision-making process?
That's a good question. I don't think I can give you a definitive answer to that. It's something that we've thought about quite a lot. And in many ways, I think we really need to, we have insight from our reviews from the reports, but those reports will have some sensitivity analysis and some uncertainty analysis that ought to tell us something about that and what might be acceptable. But we haven't sat down and formally tried to structure what that information would be.
What we can do is kind of generalize what the uncertainty looks like, but can't quantify it specifically for every location. But in general, it's like the closer you are to the stream, the closer you are to the river, there's less certainty that that's going to have higher impact. As you start to move away, the uncertainty grows a little bit about what that depletion rate is. But here's what's interesting, is it peaks out somewhere at some moderate distance from the river, and then starts to reduce again as you get further and further from the river, because those impacts are just less likely to reach the river in a given amount of time. So that's the general description that's in the reports, is this this uncertainty curve, if you will, as you move away from the river. It's less uncertain right next to the river, greatest uncertainty at a moderate distance, and then as you get further away, it becomes less uncertainty again.
But site-specific uncertainty is important to a particular permittee or applicant who has to mitigate his stream capture. And if the error is plus or minus 20%, you know, that translates to real dollars in terms of the cost of mitigating any groundwater capture.
Yeah. Agreed. It can go either way.
Yeah, exactly. It's plus or minus.
Yeah.
And so I don't know. I'm not suggesting a way to deal with it. I'm just, that's going to cause some people a lot of angst.
Yes.
I think.
Understood.
And it makes sense that it would. But I think one way to think about it is like, how could you quantify the uncertainty if all this behavior is based on the properties of the aquifer at any given location? I mean, the models do the best they can to come up and estimate those properties.
Exactly.
But there's so many places where there's just no data that they do these interpolations to fill in what the understanding is there. But we would never know what the exact properties are throughout the system for all locations. And so there's always going to be some amount of uncertainty. And so, you know, it's just, but what this does is it does give us a much better sense of what those captures are. And when you say, you know, it's going to give angst to the groundwater user when they're looking at the results, because they don't know if it's, you know, if there is a higher uncertainty or not. It also gives angst to the surface water guys. Well, exactly. Water is being captured. And so it works both ways. And, you know, you just hope that you split the middle through it all, if you will, and that the average is, you know, that you are getting the right answer mostly, you know, and doing the best we can with what we have in available science. But it's just to have an expectation that somehow we know everything everywhere, it's just, there's just no way we can get there.
Well,
we do the best we can with the technology we have and the data and information, and, you know, maybe through time, an additional process, maybe through time that they could be constrained more as there's more additional data in the future. But we've got to start somewhere.
Exactly.
And that's where we're starting with here.
Yeah, I agree. I understand model uncertainty, but the individual permittees or applicants, those are the people who are going to be impacted both on the surface water and the groundwater. And I don't know how you deal with it. I'm not smart enough to offer a suggestion.
Thanks, Dale. I think just in interest of time, so that we can have maybe a longer Q&A at the end, I'm going to move along and trade off here now. I know we were hoping to talk for an hour and have an hour worth of questions. You've consumed 5 minutes of our Q&A. Thank you, guys.
I don't know when to shut up.
I'm not going to say myself. Usually it's me who overtalks. Okay, so next step. So this is the transfer slide over to Kip. So the real question here now, after we get these results, which is a big deal, it's how can the models be used to investigate the viability of potential solutions to help manage the capture problem? So what can we use these models for, you know, once we've got those results, once we've got those two, and what can the model also tell us that we haven't explored yet? So with that, and with me losing my voice, I'm going to turn it over to Kip.
All right. Thanks, John. All right. So my responsibility here today is to talk about, as John said, using the models to kind of evaluate the conjunctive management concepts as we move forward. Adam's going to talk more about how that process is going to work moving forward. But the idea is we can use these models as a tool to understand what the potential effects on the system are going to be, what the potential effects on users are going to be, as well as how much water it might make for the river. And so I'm going to talk about examples of analysis and scenarios and potential solutions that can be part of this capture management framework, if you will. And so some of the stuff I'm going to show is going to be a little bit scary. And I just want to make sure everybody knows that these are just concepts. These are not necessarily things that we're talking about or anything like that here, but just so everybody gets in a sense of how these tools can be used, okay? And I'll start off with what I think is the very scariest of them all, which is curtailment by priority, okay? We start with this because this is one of the only tools in Adam's toolbox. This is the one he has. We've known for a long time, you know, in the Humboldt that this to take this approach to reduce capture on the river would have devastating consequences to the economy. There'd be a lot of people that would be impacted that are using groundwater that are possibly having no impact on the river, so that you could get to groundwater that is having impact on the river. But nonetheless, the models are set up such that a scenario as drastic as this could be evaluated. Now, I'm hoping that we don't go down this road, but this is going to be an open process, so we don't know where things are going to go as of right now, so that's going to be up to everybody, and we're looking forward to that part of the process. Now, let's talk about something that John mentioned, and I'll use his slide, is, what about if we were to think about focused curtailment based on actual impact, or if we established capture zones or some sort of threshold, where we said, these wells that are in these areas of greatest impact, of greatest groundwater surface water connection, if we focused in on that, if we said arbitrarily, if it was the 60% contour, for example, we can use the models that select all wells within that 60% band, and curtail those
rerun the models and see how much water that would generate in the stream. And then we'd also be able to look at how much groundwater would that curtail, so that we'd be able to look at those components to get an idea of what's the size of the impact, what would it do for the river, what would that do for the senior water right irrigators that are using the Humboldt Creek. Okay, so that's one example. And this next example is another example of curtailment, whereas we might say, you know what, these capture zones, and this would be something we're working out with everybody, is like, they're nice, but it's really a little bit complicated because they vary up and down the river. What if we just decided to do something that was a more simple management scheme and said, there's a fixed distance to the river that has an impact. And so here I just threw in these buffer lines of a mile or 2 miles to make an example where you could say, tell the model, hey, select all the wells within this fixed distance of the river and or tributary and curtail those, run the model, see how much water that generates in the stream, see how many acre feet that curtails the groundwater pumping, and get a sense of what that management strategy might be. Okay. And so I'm telling all this to everyone that's online and in this room to start your motors thinking about what are the solutions, because that's going to come up later when Adam's talking. So these are all potential scenarios and other scenarios that we haven't even thought about yet, because we have a ton of great ideas that are sitting out there with our stakeholders that we want to hear about. One of the other concepts that has been thrown around, and this is a promising concept, is the use of artificial storage and recovery. We just generically call it ASR here. The models, we can use the models to help us identify locations where ASR might be more promising than other areas. We need to look for areas that have a thick unsaturated zone, so there's storage room for water to be stored in the ground. It needs to be somewhat permeable so the water can get into the ground, as well as for water to move towards the stream. And of course, the best ASR opportunities are probably going to be closer to the river, a little distance away, so you can have an unsaturated zone, but you're able to get the water from the river to the location, ASR location, as well as the recharge effects won't take forever to start making having benefit to the stream. I'm thinking a lot about ASR this year because, you know, we don't know what's exactly going to happen in the Humboldt. We might find out on April 11th during the water supply update. But we know that in the eastern front of the Sierra here, we're seeing a lot of water go out in the desert. Everybody's thinking about ASR this year. It's like, where could we put water in the ground this year if we were more prepared and ready to put it in the ground? So anyway, ASR is a big idea. The models will help us understand if you did put them in some locations that are being evaluated. You get a sense of how much impact that's going to have on the stream and how long will it take. That's what the models will tell us. The one thing the models don't tell us is, hey, 2023 is going to be a great year, and we're going to have years like 2017 and 2023 every 6 years now. It's obviously nothing's going to tell us that. We're just at the whims of nature for what the actual climate looks like moving forward from year to year. So the models will not do that for us. Okay. This is kind of related to what we're doing now these days in evaluating new applications or change applications. The models can be useful for looking at and evaluating what types of offsets can be used to offset the capture curve. Let me see if I got the mouse here. There we go. Okay, so what the models do for us, of course, is they give us this character, this capture estimate based on any given location within the model domain. And then we can evaluate potentially using decree water to offset that capture. And this is an example that we have And the blue curve, of course, is the capture from groundwater pumping. But these orange bars is evaluating a particular decree right in the river that's is being proposed to offset this curve. And it shows the variability of that decree over time, as you can see here. And what we're trying to do is, you know, use that decree to offset the vast majority of this capture, but in cumulatively to offset it. But there's always going to be times when you just can't do it. So this evaluation for the decree is not able to be evaluated with the models, but we have a tool in-house that we've been working on and developing and been using in the Humboldt on testing and evaluating that helps us translate decree rights into basically wet water. What's the value? What's the replacement value using that decree to replace for to offset groundwater? So the models are useful for giving us that capture component. This part is outside of it, but we're developing a tool for that that will be available someday. Another example is to that could be considered is trying to offset capture by moving groundwater rights with respect to each other and playing with their magnitudes of their duties. This is an example of a water right away from the river being moved closer to the river because it's a groundwater right moving closer to the river. It has this initial spike where it's going up. But because a bigger, greater quantity of duty further away was moved in, it's got this character where it starts to offset after a short period of time, and then starts to counteract and offset the impacts from that. So the blue curve shows net impact. The red bars show that existing groundwater right that was moved. Let me show this. And so what we see is if you're going to take an approach like this, is like, okay, well, we might have a short-term problem where we have greater capture from a move like this, but over time it starts to offset itself. And so in the long term, it decreases that impact of that capture. The problem with this particular analysis is that it doesn't offset all of the entire capture within 50 years. So these are ideas. We're just throwing them out there for people to think about and different approaches that we can use. And this is the groundwater offset example. Okay, moving on. Conservation is almost certainly going to be part of the solution at some point in time. We talked this morning, we had a meeting, we were talking about conservation a fair amount. And this example is from Diamond Valley. These pictures are from Diamond Valley. And changing our sprinkler types from this mid-elevation spray application type to low elevation spray application so that there's less water being caught in the wind. And as Justin likes to say, it's making fewer rainbows. And so you're, in order to get the same amount of water to the crops, you're actually using less. And so this is an example of a conservation concept that could be evaluated with the models because you just adjust the amount of pumping requirement at all these sites that make these adjustments to see how much of effect does that have on the river and how much does that affect the overall withdrawal at that location. Another example that I don't have a slide for is like various channel conservation projects that might lead to more flow in the river. Some of those can be evaluated the models. Some of them can't. It all depends on the specific example that's being considered. All right, and this is my last slide. The models, they do a fair amount, but they're really water models, they're groundwater models, hydrologic models, but they're not economic models. And so one of the main limitations is that we can do all this estimation with these models to figure out what the overall impacts are of our management decisions or potential decisions and options and concepts, but it doesn't quite translate to dollars. And so there's a whole other component where we need to figure out, well, what's the economic benefit or cost of those solutions? The model doesn't simulate human behavior. And so the concept of capture assessments, which was discussed in the past as an option, potential option for capture management, contingent management, it can't model what behavior of people is and what that cost limit is, where they'd start to make adjustments or start to move their water rights and things like that. The models have various specific limitations, and some of them that some of the mountain locations just aren't going to produce sensible results. And we're masking those locations out. Where we have the mines and more data, they do a lot better. And then finally, we do have connected tributaries in the system, especially in the upper Humboldt, that we weren't able to get into the models because of the density of those of that network. And so there might be some connected tributaries that we are not able to get a full understanding of what the potential capture is on those or water rights right next to those particular streams. Okay, and so with that, I'm just going to move it on to the next slide for Adam to close out our conversation here. Thanks.
Okay, so we talk about developing a conjunctive management framework, and we know where we need to get. It's this capture curve, it needs to be reversed. That's in simple terms, that's what we're trying to accomplish. There's different kinds of ways to get there, different combinations of things that can work together that are gonna benefit the whole system. And this is again where I wanna kind of point it to, how does this affect you? How does it, what does this mean? And how do you get, where's your opportunity to contribute ideas or to help steer us in the right direction as the state agency? What we've seen as Kip's walked through here is it's a number of general scenarios and how those could be evaluated with the tools that we have. These really are scenarios that we've been talking about for years, or some version of that that's been recommended, that we've discussed publicly, that we've discussed internally as what do you really do here? There's a lot of other ideas too that people have suggested in previous meetings, in other hearings that we've had. So that's not the limit of what we're aware of and that we're thinking. But we know there's more. The real goal is to implement strategies that have the most benefit to the system and have the least negative impact on groundwater users. Because you're still thinking about the optimal beneficial use of the resource by those water right holders without conflicting with senior rights. And that is still the objective. Now, whether these strategies are initiated by the state and directed by the state, or they're in cooperation and it's a private party type of agreement that doesn't rely or the state that doesn't necessarily have authority but we could be supportive of. There's a lot of different ways to get there. So thinking about the process and the sequence and what we're doing next, we want to have people submit concepts, proposals, ideas to us that you think maybe we either haven't thought of or that you think are really just the right way to do it. Maybe it's obvious to you what we need to do. Please tell us that. We're going to schedule a listening session to take those input. We want people to come be constructive and bring ideas and work through it and be on the front end of this. We'll run those scenarios. We can do the evaluation using the models. We can communicate what that tells us publicly, and then turn that into a more formal process of that of what overall forms a conjunctive management framework. So here's kind of the timeline that we penciled out, which says basically what I just talked about. We're thinking about by July 1st of this year, we want to get input from people. In part, that's waiting. That's after the legislative session is over. There's some concepts in the legislature that, if passed, could be I think, beneficial or complementary to the concepts that we're working through and could be informative and helpful to water users. It also kind of times this as best we can with having the models available to evaluate scenarios. We want to have at least one or maybe multiple listening sessions this summer to take input and potentially work with people who bring ideas forward to help flesh those out and make sure it's understood or optimized. The next step is to evaluate those scenarios, to communicate the results, and then in the final upper right where I say conjunctive management, you know, some of the standards we need concepts to be accessible to people, to users, make it understandable, make it measurable so we can demonstrate what's working. If it's not working, if it's not meeting our expectations, then, you know, reevaluate and try something different. Make it defensible so that, you know, these decisions are science-based. They're functioning at the most local level possible with buy-in and participation. And most of all, effective. It's got to work. That curve has got to turn the other way. And that's our overall goal, really, in the long term. And with that, I will be quiet and open it up to questions. Can people type in?
Yeah, questions? Question right here. Do the models account for multiple wells in a given area and their combined influences on groundwater levels and surface water flows? In these situations, can the impact of a single well be quantified?
The answer is yes. and you can think of it like this. This is one way to think about it. But you could have one well that pumps 200 acre feet, or you could have two wells in the same location that pump 100 acre feet each. It's the same thing. That's how the models see things. They don't see things as the number of sticks in the ground, but the amount of water that's being withdrawn from a given location.
Maybe for that. I don't know. Sometimes some folks have asked questions about multiple wells that aren't necessarily in the same spot and whether the impacts are additive or not. I think in some cases, if there are other things that you capture, like graphites at the same time, there can be non-linearities that happen in that case in the models, for example. So you can simulate that, but it's maybe not quite as straightforward as, for example, just putting one point on capture map. Not being very clear on this, I know, but sometimes if you have several wells in one area and you actually lower the water table below where graphites can get that water, the dynamics change. And so that's not as well predicted by a capture map as the models would. So there may be cases where the models are actually more effective than something like a capture map.
How much longer must we report meter readings?
It's forever. I guess that's
the answer to that. It's maintaining good data on pumpage is a critical component going forward to understand effects of pumping and know what's being pumped. And as long as those orders were 1051, 1251. And as long as those orders are in place, we need to continue to include that as part of the regional water management scheme.
Do you anticipate statutory changes will be required, regulations, or both? Will be required, or regulations, or both?
Yeah, that's a really good question. So, I don't necessarily believe that statutory changes are required to do anything that we're talking about here. There's a couple of statutory proposals that are being negotiated or worked through in the legislature right now that I think would be helpful and clarify the legislative intent, and also that provides some opportunities to help give some more tools here. I don't think it's necessary, but it would be helpful. As far as regulations, that's another question and an interesting one I didn't talk about. Does it make sense, or is it necessary for the state to adopt regulations to go forward and basically do this through administrative code rather than through order or just policy? And there's certainly potential for that. There's advantages to administrative code. It provides a lot of certainty and clarity and procedural support in defending what we're doing. It also takes a long time. And there's some things that might suit it for regulation, but there's a lot of other things that I think would make a lot of it makes sense to either just be more directly implemented through either by order or by policy, or just a groundwater management plan, or different structures. So regulations are a possibility, but not absolutely necessary.
Is flood irrigation versus spray irrigation taken into account?
In the models, they're assigned different efficiencies based on the application rate. So based on the application method. So they are from that aspect. Now, where it gets challenging is when they're changing application methods through time. And to capture that precisely, I would say that that's not necessarily captured perfectly because methods change through time, and it's really difficult to capture that. So the models do the best they can to capture the majority and to make the changes when they're known. But for the most part, yeah, they take it into account by the efficiency of basically the consumptive use efficiency or the return rate efficiency, however you want to think about it.
If curtailment was good for Moapa Valley, why can't we do it on the Humboldt River?
I'm not sure what that. Can we unmute that person?
Terry, do you want to come on the microphone?
They curtailed 1983 and post seniority on wells down there, did they not, on the Mud River?
Maybe what he's referring to is curtailment as far as no additional appropriations. Not sure what happened in 1983. But oftentimes when we talk about curtailment, a curtailment order issued by the state engineer says that no new appropriations from here on out will be issued. And that's referred to as a curtailment order. And that's already in place in a lot of the areas that we're talking about here.
So jump down to my next question. If stream capture exists at any level, why would you accept new applications at all for wells, period?
Well, I think for one, if they don't cause any more stream capture, then we wouldn't have grounds to deny that. We would have to have grounds to demonstrate that there would be a conflict. So if they're far enough away from the river or somehow disconnected, then we wouldn't have a reason to deny that. A valid reason or a defensible reason. If they were close and they did demonstrate capture, then we would deny it unless they could avoid that capture using some other method, like reducing duty in another well, for example, or doing some kind of an offset, for example. But the only way we would grant those would be by relying on defensible data that indicates that they can avoid any conflict.
Well, again, if the capture exists at any level, and it's already pretty much a given, stream capture exists, and the Humboldt stream system was declared by Judge Bartlett back in 1938 that it's, or 31, that it's fully appropriated then, and now we keep going through like we're trying to do the Bartlett decree all over again, only this time it involves stream capture. And so if stream capture exists at even the smallest amount up and down the entire Humboldt River stream system, its tributaries and its basins, then why on earth would you continue to allow anybody to come in and file an application and accept an application for any water whatsoever over and above what's not maybe backed by either decreed, certificated, certificated, decreed, vested water rights to back it up? Because I mean, how many what are we going back here, you know, 80 years or something to rehash the Bartlett decree? It took three judges, 15 years plus the Nevada Supreme Court, and we're fighting over the Humboldt River water all over again. It's just like it's all forgotten.
Thanks for those comments. It's, you know, you bring up a lot of good points, and these are things that we've been working on, and that's part of the consideration. Next question.
Curtailment of pumping based on proximity to river is potential adverse to curtailment by priority and the integrity of the prior appropriation system, right?
Got a question?
Yeah, there's a question. That's a question. It was Chris Mahana.
Yeah.
Thanks, guys. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
So my question is, and we actually did this back in the early 1990s, where we had an agreement with Westpac to curtail their pumping on within a half a mile of the river. It was far from a perfect solution, but I guess the question that comes up is, if you do that, you're potentially adverse to the prior appropriation system if you're curtailing a very senior water right that is adjacent to the river, but a junior groundwater right that's outside of that band or 1 mile or whatever you choose would still be allowed to pump. And I can see folks making an argument that that is adverse to the first in time, first in right.
Yeah, it's first scenarios. I sort of took that to the extreme and
demonstrated
why that's a problem.
Yeah, and Chris, I was just gonna say, Chris, I didn't throw that slide up there because we thought it was a good idea. Just because it has been a consideration in the past, as you're saying, and also if you wanted to consider a simplified system that wasn't completely science-based, but was had some sort of rationale to it, just knowing that the way physics works is the closer you are, you generally have higher capture, and the further you are, the less, then, you know, that could be a system envisioned as a potential solution. Now, I did throw that up there because I think that's the way we should go, or anything like that, or that's what we're talking about. I just threw it up there that that's the type of evaluation we could do. The legal ramifications of it, your guess is as good as mine, and other people probably have better guesses on that. So, Chris, before you go on, I'm going to ask you, if you think that the same thing for if you're managing based on the capture zones or the thresholds slide, do you think that would be a similar argument with that approach?
Not quite sure of your question, but I've stated all along, I completely agree with all of the tools you guys have suggested, and I don't think there's any one size fits all or silver bullet. I think it's going to have to be a creative mix of all of those, hopefully with curtailment being lower on the list, because it is a very draconian measure. And as you guys have pointed out with your modeling, even after you curtail, the capture still continues to persist in some cases for decades. And just one other tool, it sounds counterintuitive, but Colorado's been successful in doing this, where they have what they call recharge wells, where they actually pump wells that are distant from the river and have a much longer capture effect and actually pumping groundwater to the river. And it's all accounted for in their augmentation plans. So that's maybe another tool in the toolbox to look at.
Thanks, Chris.
If I voluntarily cut back on my allocation during a dry year, could I then use that water in a wet year?
I would say that's touching on a bigger regional management question that could combine voluntary cutbacks between dry years and wet years, and really help them offset most acute capture or conflict impacts. So yeah, there's a possibility for that. And that's one of those complex scenarios that I think the modeling can really tell us a lot about effectiveness of doing that by location, by region. Do you guys agree with that?
I would agree, but it's going to depend on the nature of that connection between that location where the well is and the river. The closer it is to the river, the more that might work, because it has to be able to capture water within a single season for that concept to work. But I would say if somebody's right on the river, that's definitely a concept that works, because if the river's in full priority, or if serving full priority, then there's water available to be captured out of the river. And if you turn on your pumps and it captures water right away, well, then they should be in priority and should be able to take water. As far as getting credit for water you're voluntarily not using and carrying over to another year, I think that's a whole other conversation that we're not really having that right now.
Yeah. Just thinking about voluntary cutbacks.
Yeah, voluntary cutbacks are definitely something that, not an idea.
And that's something we're seeing in a lot of different places around the state, where local users just recognize that something's got to be done, and where voluntary cutbacks can be just implemented for low value crops. You know, it's you can measure the benefits of that, and it can make sense by the irrigator rather than have a state imposed cutback. You know, there's things that can just be done at the local voluntary scale that can avoid problems. So if it works, we want to accommodate.
Will the time since pumping started to be considered because older wells will capture more?
Oh yeah, it's a complex. I mean, it's a very straightforward question. It's a good question, and it's one that we're considering all the different. We're considering how to approach that, and that's kind of one of the things we're hoping to work out in these listening sessions when folks are bringing their ideas and proposals, and we're kind of go when we roll up our sleeves and really start to get into this. It's like the bigger picture on the timing. You know, does it start from now, or does it start from the past, or, you know, exactly how does that work? We don't have a decision on that as far as I'm
I think that goes to a lot of the questions that have to do with managing groundwater and surface water in combined, because the timings are so different between the two, where if surface water is there, you can get it. In groundwater, it's sort of always there, but the impacts from it drag out over time, and it gets to be the challenge to manage that together, but they are interconnected and they do behave in response to each other. And there's going to be any number of questions like that about legacy capture, about the effectiveness of turning off a well to support more river flow and the timing of that, because it may take a fair amount of time, it may be spread out over years. Simply turning off a well, like Kip had said, doesn't mean that water stays in the river during that period when it's off. And that's all a function of how close you are to the river.
If stream capture exists at any level, why would new applications be accepted on the Humboldt stream system?
Yeah, we answered that question earlier.
We did, but to expand on that a little bit, applications that we're currently receiving, we evaluate for potential conflict. And if evaluation demonstrates that we would conflict with an existing right, then those applications are denied.
Is there a planned audit of 2016 to 2022 data on river flows to the model predictive results as a test of model calibration quality?
That's a great question. It would only apply to the middle model because that's the only one that's simulating stream flow or variable stream flow. And I think that's a great idea and one that could be implemented as a scenario to do a post audit and see how it's doing on simulating the stream flows. So good idea.
Do you definitively feel you have statutory authority to conjunctively manage legacy capture from existing UG rights and require replacement water or the other tools Kip outlined?
Everything that we're doing, we believe that this is what water law instructs us to do as a state agency. I think there's room for some clarity in statute because I know people have different opinions or have offered or suggested that there's ambiguity. And so clearing that up is helpful. But I have confidence that this is what we can do to honor the science and follow the law.
Do you anticipate that this model will speed up the process for POD applications? So possibly a matter of weeks instead of months or years?
That's, I would say that it's the hope, because right now for us to, when we get an application, each one's individually evaluating, and that's a pretty tedious process, and we have very limited staff for it, and our staff is always working on other things like this, like moving and stuff like that. So if we had tools available for the water resource community to use, and they can use those, and they're the same tools that we're using, I would think that would greatly speed up, it could potentially greatly speed up the process. I think that's the hope for all this. I don't know if anybody else has anything to add.
Yeah, I agree.
Okay.
And then this is a follow up to the I can never say that word,
conjunctive.
Management statutory question. Do you feel you have the authority to require augmentation plans or replacement water on legacy pumping?
This question I'm not quite sure how to answer this. It gets asked a lot. Do we believe that we have the authority? Everything we're doing, we believe we have the authority to do it. But we have to work incrementally and get the proper legal evaluation and support where it's questioned.
For more transparency on the potential for mining impacts or lack of impacts in future pumping scenarios, can a scenario be run with existing mining pumping projected forward for 100 years? We know it is not accurate and mine pumping will vary and shift geographically. It would be insightful and more accurate than no mine pumping scenario projected forward.
That could be a scenario as well. I mean, that's useful information, you know, making some assumptions about what additional pumping in the bedrock might do to capture. I mean, the simulations that we've done historically with known mine pumping, we've been able to call that out and identify the capture related to that mine pumping. So there's no reason why we couldn't do a scenario that was made an assumption about dewater pumping and an assumption about where that might be located going forward to get some estimate of its relative impact going forward. I think the history might tell a lot about the future too on that though. We, you know, once we get those kinds of results published and people have a chance to look at that, that might help to answer those questions.
I think what I want to add to what John just responded to there was that one of the reasons the decision was made in the model to not simulate any future mine pumping is that the impacts of mine pumping are largely masked by mine water discharge right now and going into the near future. As long as they're pumping, they're putting water in the ground closer to the river. They're also dumping, discharging to the river. And those tend to mask out capture that's occurring in the river. And so you really don't see the impacts of mines until they stop dewatering and stop discharging to the river and stop putting water into rifts and recharging the groundwater system. And so that was one of the reasons why we decided to look at that. See, what does it look like when you actually stop discharging? So, hopefully that answered that question.
You mentioned a new in-house tool to evaluate using decreed surface water to evaluate offset of capture. Can you expand on the tool?
Sure. So it's not a complicated thing, but it's I think it's complicated to describe. So I'll give it a try though. So the way that we conceptualize deliveries for the surface water is based on a priority that's measured are determined from the Palisade gauge flows. So a lot of the surface water users recognize this, that, you know, the Palisade gauge is kind of a measure of priority. So if there's a lot of water measured being flowing past the Palisade gauge, the priorities go up and down, more people in the decree get their water. Well, what we've done is we take the historical flows, the daily historical flows pointed by Palisade, and we've looked at that history of deliveries for the earliest 55 years or so of time that we have from those records. And we basically say, well, how many days out of the season for each one of those years was a given priority date in priority? And if it was half of those years, they would then get half of the water that their duty allows in the decree, and that's how it's served. So we simulated what they should have got for a like 50, 55 year period before pumping ever started, because we didn't want the impacts from pumping to be in those records. And we developed this 50 year history of, you know, water that's being served to different priorities. And we could plot that up and we could determine, for example, if you had the most senior priority, you'd get your water essentially 100% of the days in the season. So you got all your water. But if you had a very junior priority like 1921, you might, in a bad year, you might get 10, 15 days, or maybe no days of your water during that year. So we replicated all of those years. We looked at how wet your water was for each one of those years. Maybe you get 100% of the water in a wet year and only 50 in a dry year, but we took all that history of climate and we ran each one and we randomized those like they would happen over and over again, like 5,000 times in a row. And we came up with, well, what was the average amount of days that a person with that seniority should have got his water over that period of time? So you might have a decreed duty of 180 feet, But historically, based on your priority, you only got 50% of the time. So that wet water factor would be 58. So what we're trying to do is we're kind of trying to come up with how much of a water right do you need in water that will actually be in the river to offset the capture that you're actually going to take out of the river. And if those two things are equal, then that avoids conflict. You're leaving water, your free water in the stream that you own or you control in exchange for pumping that slowly but surely maybe grows to the point where it matches that. And that's the whole idea of an offset from a technical perspective.
That's it so far in here.
Oh. Sam. Several years ago, during this extended drought, when there were claims made from the lower end of the system users on the state engineer to curtail use of both surface and groundwater of upstream users who had junior rights, the state engineer determined that even if he can curtail or prohibited use of both surface and groundwater in the upper and middle systems, still that water would not reach the lower end, and hence he did not go through any curtailment. Does the model modeling that was done, does it take into factor that type of scenario where and we're saying, all right, well, in the middle system or in the upper system, a well is 20% depletion or impact on the flow of the river. Well, even if that was shut off, it wouldn't benefit a lower system, because the senior water right holders, because of the drought. Is that considered at all?
Yeah. That would be a perfect scenario to run. And those are the kinds of things that when we think about validating solutions or scenarios, we would look at. So some of the tips examples of where, what if we curtail everybody who's within 1 mile of river? Well, we could simulate that and actually look at the next year or the next year or the next year and see what impact, beneficial impact that might have on the river to make sort of judgments relative to how effective is that solution? I mean, is that what might be called a futile call, you know, in the short term, or is it a benefit in the midterm or not? You know, so I think, again, the timing questions get real sticky in terms of expecting a groundwater curtailment to solve a short-term surface water problem. I mean, we do want to avoid conflict, but there's science and reality in terms of how to go about it that complicate that picture. It's not as simple as turning off all the wells and expecting the river to come back, for example, and that's an extreme example, and I know a poor one, but it's what comes into my head.
And so I'm just going to add a little bit to that for you, Sam, and I think let's think back to the days where there was a real quick analysis done using Glover solution just to get a sense during that previous drought. What you know, if we were to take all these actions in this 1 year, how much flow would we see coming down the river this season? You know, and that's, you know, now, and the point of those conversations was like, there's a lag to groundwater, and that's why we can't operate groundwater like we do surface water. We can just say, oh, well, we'll just curtail for this year since it's a dry year, and, you know, and that'll put more water in the river, where the fact is it might put just a little bit more water in the river for that 1 year, but it's only for those people that are pumping right on the river, whereas the majority of the impacts are lagged. And those will take multiple years to take effect. So you could curtail someone this year for a drought, but their curtailment might take 5 or 10 years for that to actually arrive at the river. And so curtailing groundwater on a seasonal basis, anywhere except for right on the river corridor itself, the timing just don't work. And that's really, you know, a lot of what John was saying. It's just the timing's off. So.
Well, if we have a continued drought, our extended drought, no curtailments may provide water to the lower system. If Peter Ogden's diaries and observations and the historical record is set, there were extended periods of time that lower end of the system didn't get any water.
And 2021 or 2022 was much like that. We didn't get any water down there, so it's, I've seen that. Can you see if anybody has a hand up? Or, yeah.
Nope.
All right, well, I, well,
no.
Oh, slide 21, why does capture jump in 2016?
Because we're doing it.
I don't know if I need to go back to that slide.
So I'll bring it up.
Okay, thank you. So this is, I think this might have been the curve with all the colored plots of the various hydrographic areas. Is that the one that shows a jump going from the historical period to the predicted period?
Yeah.
And some of this, Kip can probably help with this one too, because we've gone around and around on this one. And one of the things that happens is if we go from actual historical flow in the middle of Humboldt, which in 2015 was very low, as you guys all know, that's a drop, to using in the model median values of flow. So you can imagine you're going from a dry year where perhaps there are parts of the river that are entirely dry, and if it's dry, you capture zero, right? So the actual capture amounts in those dry years go down. You know, you think about why in the dry year are you not capturing more of the river water? Well, the reason is because there's less water to capture. And so those values in of capture amounts in 12, 13, 14, 15 actually are some of the lowest in the recent 20 years or so. And then it jumps. And so some of that can be explained by the fact that the simulation of a river to a wetter river will allow for more capture. I think also that role of the mine impact plays a role here, where in this case, I believe that historical pumpage is exclusive of mine capture. So those historical values in these basins is diminished because it doesn't have the mine impacts on it. And so in reality, those should be higher. And again, that's a little bit of it's not intuitive, but I think the better curve was the previous curve that showed all three of them that would reflect reality. And those actual capture amounts on the historical side would be 1,000 to 1,500 acre feet higher because of the mine capture, and it wouldn't be quite the jump. So I think there are two reasons for that, just change in how we simulate the stream flow and the fact that we were excluding the mining.
Yeah, in retrospect, we should have added a comment to the slide that kind of explained that, because it doesn't, this analysis that's being shown right here, the intent was to show what the impact is from the various hydrographic basins in the middle of Humboldt, excluding mines, you know. So it was a decision not to include mines in this, because it was really all the other pumping that this was evaluating. And so that really adds to that jump in character, because there's a lot less pumping in that. There's no mine pumping being included in this. So
on
the
presentation.
Yeah, it's in a
separate slide.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And so these are recycled from last year.
Right. Yeah. One of the things, and this is not a great excuse, but the published reports, they aren't available for public release. So in these slides, we were reliant on figures that were provided last year in the stakeholder meeting, of which the model hasn't changed, but the presentation formats are being revised based on comments like this, where we really should have shown then and should show in the future sort of that either include the mine pumping in that or have a comment in there on the rationale for this.
Yeah.
It's a good catch.
Yeah. Just come back and look at it. There's definitely a difference in those two curves.
Yeah, that center, the center one is that black line. You'll see is that the actual capture amounts in the historical period are bumped up relative to that, and there's a nice smooth curve. I think that's the more representative kind of a capture curve that would reflect the historical period with the mine pumping in.
Can you clarify the myth that if pumping is limited to the perennial yield estimate of each basin, the problem with capture will be solved?
Is this Chris Mahoney question?
Yes.
For me,
Kip, you know me too well.
For me, I would just look at the most extreme circumstances where you had one well that pumped perennial yield that was 5 feet away from the river. I mean, you would be at the perennial yield, but probably the models would say that 100% of that water would come out of the river, even though you're at or below the perennial yield. So location is super important relative to comparing pumping to perennial yield. And, you know, it's an imperfect mode, and it's a perennial yield has always been defined as kind of the maximum available amount. And I think the reason it's called maximum in general is because it is location dependent, and you have to have the perfect distribution of wells to really capture just the perennial yield. And in many cases, it's impossible because the perennial yield, like the phreatophytes, are right next to the river, and it's impossible to capture water that's going to those phreatophytes without capturing some amount of river water. So they're intertwined.
So thank you for that. You need to put that on a billboard on the entire Interstate 80 from Lovelock to Elko.
Well, I know that perennial yield has limitations relative to that, but I think it can be a useful threshold to have in your mind is relatively compared to other basins and an optimal way to practice, but you always have to recognize that with any given well, you've got more than just that to determine whether there's water available. And conflict question is always, you know, a big part of that. And, you know, so we've really ramped up, I think, our assessment of applications beyond just is there water available based on the perennial yield to is there water available based on the perennial yield plus any potential adverse impacts of other senior water rights, whether they be surface water or groundwater. And I don't think that's really any different than the way we've managed in the past, but in some ways the statutes read, we've talked about that, how separate sources and some of the administrative language has been a barrier to practicing what we should be preaching, I guess, in terms of how surface water and groundwater have, you know, interplay.
Yeah. And Chris, the only thing I'd add is we do have quite a few basins in Nevada that don't have these major streams running through them. And perennial yield works a little better there without regard to the locations. But they still have springs and stuff like that we got to be thinking about. So when you spend your time in the river basins like you and I do, it's like, you know, it's like, well, how can perennial yield work here? You know, we get it. But we do have places where it does work a little better.
Yeah, I fully get that. And I should have clarified that in my question. So thanks.
Would you agree that the underground pumping within the Humboldt River basins is a part of the Humboldt River stream system?
It's kind of semantics. We look at it as a regional connected system. The stream is the stream. It's, you know, it's administered by the Cree for the reasons that it Cree works on a river system. The extent that groundwater is connected to the river, you got to consider that. You know,
I would add that there, you know, for the most part, groundwater is part of the system for the most part. But there's places in the Humboldt River system where you could pump for who knows how long, and all you do is capture phreatic ET, and it would never actually reach the stream within thousands of years, you know. And so there are places where it is isolated enough where you could think of it as being disconnected, but in some true continuum sense, there everything is all connected. So.
I just had to comment on that because the USGS, we have that discussion a lot. We get asked that question a lot. And the reason that there's flow in the river in September is because it's being fed from the bottom. It's aquifer water seeping in to provide base flow to the stream. So in that sense, you know, they are part of the same system.
And I guess in the larger picture, that's what congested management really means. It's like looking at groundwater and surface water as a single resource and managing them in such a way that you understand what you're doing to one is going to have an effect on the other. And that's truly what congested management is. What we're trying to do.
I think it's worthwhile thinking of this overlapping systems in a way. I mean, because as Kit describes, you know, you can pump groundwater and actually capture storage or actually capture phreatobites or capture some of the river. And so it's that part of the river, the river captured, it's the overlap part, you know, between those kind of subsets or whatever you'd want to call them. And it does become semantics at some point. Well, do we want to call it a single source or two sources that have shared components or what? And I don't know, I guess you could debate that to your blue in the face without getting anywhere, but I think they do have interaction.
Okay. Can I ask a question here or add to this?
Go for it.
Yep.
I just, I'd like to recite something here from page 28 of the Bartlett Decree, paragraph 44, concerning the same. Judge Bartlett says, the court finds that the water of the stream system is fully appropriated and that in an average year, as shown by the flow in the said stream system, there is no surplus water for irrigation. I think that's a pretty good summary of what we're talking about here. Thank you.
Thanks, Jerry.
Jeff, did you have a question?
Yeah, I do. And the state engineer is probably going to get tired of me asking this question, but I want to be absolutely clear in my mind about two of the options that were put up on the screen earlier, and that is curtailment by capture and curtailment by the zone. And it was brought up earlier, I think, by Chris Mahan about whether or not that runs afoul of the prior appropriation doctrine. But I guess my very specific question is, today, is that something that the Division of Water Resources can actually do?
What was the question? Can we actually do what?
Curtail by capture.
Oh, well,
by zone.
Yeah, I mean, when we were talking about capture, we're talking about conflict. And to address conflict, we need to consider priority. So it's, does that answer your question? I think we not only can do it, I think the law tells us that we have to do that. And we're relying on the science to identify where that conflict is occurring.
So let's ask Jeff a question to clarify. In this one, Jeff, where are you getting at that you think that the way the law is that the only way you can like curtail for conflict is to do it by priority until you get to the conflicting rights?
At a basin scale.
I don't have an opinion. I'm trying to get the answer. So I mean, if those are two options that we want to talk about, I just want to make sure that they're viable options. That's all.
So Jeff, one thing I think about a little bit, I think about the curtailment idea, even like on surface water, and I mean, location does matter there too. And people know more about this than I do that are in the audience, I'm sure. But I think about a scenario where you've got a real senior right up on Rabbit Creek, middle of the summer, and yeah, there's still water in Palisades, it's flowing, but he's not getting his water on Rabbit Creek and he's dry. And he says, well, how come down on Palisades there's a 1900 that's getting his water? Shouldn't they be curtailed? And I would say no, because even if you did curtail them, that would just be water that would then go down to the sink or somewhere else, because that guy who's senior is in a place where any amount of curtailment downstream isn't going to give him any water because he's on a dry tributary in the creek. And in some ways, I think about that with the groundwater too. I say, well, the curtailment can have benefits. The groundwater guy, he's junior, yeah. He's 20 miles from the river. So if you tell him not to pump, it's not going to add any more water to the river. So would he be a candidate for curtailment? And that's sort of, I mean, I think they're similar in analogy, because neither would have a beneficial effect. And I don't think DWR would want to do any, recognizing that there'd be no beneficial impact to doing so. And I don't know if that helps, but that's sort of how I think about the whole idea of managing for conflict using priorities. It's like two questions. One, is the person who's impacted senior? And then the answer is yes. Then you go further. Is there somebody who's causing that? If the answer is yes, then maybe there's a candidate there. But if the answer is no, then you don't say just because he's junior, you curtail him. So I think priority and conflict go hand in hand. They're kind of two stages in assessment. I don't know if I'm clear on that, but that's, again, that's my personal way I think about it.
No, that's really...
It would be like, say, we're, you know, curtailing on a statewide basis because you're in the Humboldt. We're not going to curtail, you know, somebody in Vegas, you know, because of a problem in the Humboldt. That just makes it makes sense. But we're taking it a little bit closer, so it starts to get grayer and grayer the closer you get. And I understand that, you know. And so, how do we define who's within the zone of curtailment? And we're talking about these things like, well, the greater impact, or is it all any impact at all, or is it 10%, or is it right down to zero? Can we measure that? Then that's where the management part gets tough, if we think about curtailment.
We are out of time. I really appreciate everybody's participation and the good questions and sticking around for 2 hours listening to us. This is what this has been recorded, which I hope doesn't come back to bite us or something like that. Just for the record, you know, it's good to have a sort of free conversation, and you know, even if it is being recorded, I hope that's not misused. We are looking for specific constructive ideas that will help move us forward and will be helpful. And I invite you to send those primarily to Levi, who'll be keeping track of those things. And what our intent is to take those in by July 1st. And our target is around August 1st to have a listening session, and we want people to come and turn the tables a little bit and present ideas that you think are good and that work. And we'll be continuing to communicate those schedules to this whole email list that we have for Humboldt participants. So thanks again.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you for the opportunity.